When we think of science, we often think about taking notes from our teacher, drawing diagrams, or memorizing facts. This is far from what real scientists do every day. Scientists investigate. They're curious. They follow questions that they're interested in. This might lead them to experiments or research, which could then lead them to more questions. In the spirit of doing real science, today we're going to be designing and carrying out our very own scientific inquiry. We'll begin by asking a question, then we'll formulate an experiment to test that question, and finally, we'll analyze our data and communicate what we've learned. You can plan an inquiry into anything. You could brush up on your chemistry and test how effective antacid tablets are, or you could do some physics and investigate magnetism or static electricity. Let's say we look around, we have some seeds, some soil, and a couple of pots. This lends itself perfectly to a biological inquiry into plants. The first step in our inquiry lab is to ask a question. That is, find something we don't know and ask a question about it. So, what don't we know? Well, I'm curious if it's possible to grow plants using different light sources. Or maybe we could look into what kind of soil plants like best. Or we could even look at how much water plants need. Or maybe we could see how well plants grow on the moon. Your question could be anything that's possible using the resources you have available, although you should make sure it's something that you actually care about the answer to. I might care a lot about whether plants grow well on the moon, but it might not be feasible for me to go to the moon to do the experiment. Just for an example, let's ask a simple question. How does the amount of sunlight impact plant growth? After we've asked our question, the next step is to create a starting point for our inquiry and construct a hypothesis. A hypothesis is a fancy science word for a proposed explanation of an observation. We use it as a starting point for our inquiry. An important characteristic of a hypothesis is that it must be testable. That is, we need to be able to perform a test to see whether our hypothesis is true or not. If it's not testable, it's not much use to us. A hypothesis in our experiment with plants and lights could be: plants exposed to more sunlight will grow better than plants exposed to less. This statement explains what we think will happen. More sunlight equals better growth, and is testable. We can grow multiple plants with varying amounts of sunlight and observe the results. Now that we have our question and our hypothesis, it's time for the next step, which is to design our experiment. Now that we've asked a question and identified our hypothesis, it's time to test that hypothesis using an experiment, AKA the fun part. To set up an experiment, we're first going to need to identify our variables. The variables are the parts of the experiment that will change. There are two kinds of variables we will be using. First is the independent variable. This is the variable that we change in order to observe what happens. In our experiment, the amount of sunlight is going to be the independent variable because it's what we're changing. If the independent variable is the amount of natural sunlight received by the plant, the dependent variables are going to be the things that we observe about each plant as our experiment progresses. We'll make two kinds of observations today. The first is a qualitative observation. These are collected using your senses and involve descriptions. In our example, we might say that the leaves of a plant are a deep green, or maybe they've turned a pale yellow. We might say that the leaves feel stronger or weaker, or that the stem appears to be stronger. The other type of observation is a quantitative observation. These involve numbers and are collected by using tools or by counting. In our example, we might count the number of leaves on each plant, or we might measure how tall each plant has grown using a ruler. With all that out of the way, let's set up our experiment. You can organize your experiment any way you want. As long as the different test cases receive different amounts of the independent variable, and you do your best to keep the other variables the same. In our example, I'll use three identical windows and use blinds to control the amount of sunlight. One plant will receive no sunlight, one will receive half sunlight, and one will receive full sunlight. Placing a pot in front of each window, we observe at first that each test case behaves the same, as each seed germinates into a nice little seedling. However, after the germination stage, we observe that each test case begins to behave differently. Let's watch to see what happens. Now that our experiment has run its course, let's observe what happened. In our no sun case, we observe a plant that has turned a deep yellow. The plant has two leaves and is 5 centimeters tall. In the half sun case, we observe a plant that has a healthy deep green color. The plant has 4 leaves and is 10 centimeters tall. In the full sun case, we observe another plant that is a healthy deep green. This plant has 6 leaves and is 15 centimeters tall. Now that we've collected our data, it's time to take it and see what we've learned. It's time to analyze data and draw conclusions. In order to analyze it, let's put our data into a nice little table. The independent variable will be along the top, and each of the dependent variables will be along the left side. Now comes the moment of truth. Does our data refute or confirm our initial hypothesis that the plant with more sunlight grew better? Based on our observations, the plants that received the most sunlight grew the tallest, had the most leaves, and appeared the most deeply green of all test cases. Based on this data, we can indeed confirm that our hypothesis was correct. The plants receiving more sunlight did indeed grow the best. Now, as a scientist, it's also important to know if there could have been anything in the experiment that might have made our conclusions wrong. This is called a source of error. In our example, a source of error could have been biological variation between the plants that we used. If one seed naturally grew a bigger plant, then our conclusion that the bigger plant was due to more sunlight could be wrong. It could have just been a seed for a bigger plant. Sources of error don't necessarily mean that we did anything wrong. It's just important to acknowledge them so that other scientists know that we thought of everything in our experimental design. Knowing this, they can then decide for themselves if they agree with our conclusions or not. Finally, now that we've done some science and learned something new about the natural world, it's time to tell someone about it in the last step of our inquiry and communicate what we've learned. Professional scientists write about their findings in scientific journals, which are collections of scientific studies usually centered around a similar theme. We might publish our findings in the Journal of At-Home Plant Science, if only it existed. At your school, your teacher might ask you to write a lab report or do a presentation, but communicating your results could be as simple as a post on social media explaining what you found. I might post to my network that yes, plants that receive more sunlight do indeed grow bigger, and watch the likes roll in. That's it. We've gone through the process of the scientific method and created new knowledge. Our inquiry may have even prompted new questions, in which case we can just start all over again at the beginning. This is how science progresses, with scientists being curious and asking questions about the world around them, then creating hypotheses and doing inquiries to see what they find. It's really fun. So, what would you plan an inquiry into? Let me know in the comments. And as always, if you like the video, please hit the like button or subscribe to my channel. Until next time, I'm Mr. Harris, class dismissed.